Okay, let us try to understand, or let us try to find out the expression for the propagation delay. So let us again consider the inverter having, okay, this is the input, this is grounded, you consider this as VDD, and we don't have any load capacitance. This is now considered as intrinsic capacitance, which is the intrinsic to the device. Are the MOSFETs. Now let us try to define for the derivation purpose. Suppose if you are considering this as your rise and falling transitions, so let us define the TPD as from 0% to 50% of the VDD. So let us try to obtain expression for that TPD, so which is nothing but TPD is the time taken from 0% to 50%. Of course, to be very perfectly defining the TPD, so suppose if this is your input waveform, suppose this is 50%, if you write this as your output waveform, this is the exact definition of TPD, which is 50% of your input to 50% of the output, how much of the time it is taking. But for what calculation purpose, we are taking the TPD as the time taken for the output to rise from 0 to 50%. So taking this as the parameter, we can find out what is the time. We know that capacitor voltage is given by VC is equal to V final minus V final minus V initial into e power minus t by RC. Since I'm considering this TPD, which is during the rise time, you can take it as RP. So VC will be of course equal to 0.5 times VDD, and this is equal to, if it is allowed to charge infinitely, this will reach VDD, and it is minus of VDD minus, okay, VI will be 0 here, then e power minus TPD by RP into C intrinsic. Suppose, of course, now this will become 0.5 VDD minus VDD, and it is equal to minus VDD e power minus TPD by RP into C intrinsic. So if you solve for this, TPD finally comes down to ln of 2 into ln of 2 into RP into C intrinsic. This you can easily do it, and finally you can say TPD is equal to 0.693 RP into C intrinsic. Suppose if the rise time and suppose if while rising and falling, if RP is equal to RN, then during the other portion, that is from 50% to 10%, you can still take it as TPD as equal to 0.693 R equivalent into C intrinsic. So this will be the expression for RTPD. That is propagation delay. Of course, we obtained the expression for the rise time fall time, which is 2.2 times. So this is actually from 10% to 90%. This is for 0 to 50%. So this is in absence of the actual load capacitance. Suppose if you consider the load capacitance, so what happens here is, you again consider the same inverter. If I'm considering the inverter having PMOS and NMOS, now I'm having an exclusive load capacitance CL, but of course I also have the C intrinsic, so it is now VDD, and this is ground. If this is Vin and this is V naught, suppose if I want to find out what is the expression for TPD, it is now 0.693 R equivalent into C intrinsic was there earlier, now this will become C intrinsic plus CL, that is load capacitance, because this is the C intrinsic which will be there whether you put this CL or not. So this is C intrinsic. You can see these two are coming in parallel, that's I'm just adding these two. Now what I can do is, so we can actually scale this transistors. Okay, let us forget about scaling now. So let me just do this 0.69 R equivalent. Let me take out C intrinsic outside, and it is 1 plus CL into C intrinsic. Now this is the expression for TPD now. So let us try to find out what is the impact of increasing the size of this both the transistor WL. You have a WL for this, you have a WL for this. Suppose if you increase the dimension of this, we know that R equivalent will reduce by, suppose if you are scaling it by S times, it is going to reduce by S times, and C intrinsic is going to increase by S times. So typically speaking, this is independent of scaling. This is independent of scaling. And of course, what will happen to this upon scaling? So you can write it as 0.69 R equivalent by S. This is C intrinsic into S. It is 1 plus CS into, sorry, CL, that is the load capacitance into C intrinsic is S into C intrinsic. So you can see now there is no change here. So ultimately the TPD will become 0.69 R equivalent C intrinsic 1 plus CL by S into C intrinsic. This you can write it as TPD naught, which is the propagation delay due to the intrinsic capacitance and resistance, 1 plus CL into S into C intrinsic. This is the overall TPD. Okay, this is what. Now let us try to understand, if the load capacitance is very large, so how do we minimize the time? Suppose you can see here, whenever the load capacitance is very large, so now we will be just trying to concentrate on inverters driving large capacitive load. If the load is very large, so then how do we design an inverter? So let us again take the inverter here. This is CL, this is grounded, this is VDD, this is VIN, this is RP, this is RN. Now you can see, of course, we also know that whenever it is VIN, you have a driver which is actually seeing some input capacitances. So this is a driver which is seeing a capacitance of C in, which is actually equal to CGS plus CGS of P and CGS of N transistor. Because this is an inverter, this is a driver which is also made out of some MOSFETs. You can see this is actually connected to gate and source of this and gate and source of this. The gate and source capacitance is given by CGS of N, and this is CGS of P of this PMOS transistor. So let us keep this in view, that this driver is seeing this as the load capacitance for driving this inverter. Now this inverter is asked to drive this load capacitor, which is CL here. Now since CL is very large, then how do I reduce the rise time or fall time, or how do I reduce TPD? Because now TPD or whatever rise time fall time is proportional to the tau, which is a time constant. So while charging, this is time constant, while discharging, this is the time constant. So we know that it is RP into CL is tau R proportional to, and tau P is proportional to RP into, sorry, RN into CL. Since CL is very large, that's what we are considered here. Since the large capacitance is there, the only way to reduce fall time or the rise time is to reduce the value of RN or RP. If I reduce this, either RN or RP, even with the increased CL, you will have a typically lesser fall time and rise time. What I mean to say is, whenever you have a large capacitive load, now we are trying to reduce the time taken by this capacitor to charge and discharge by trying to increase the resistance, increase the dimension of this, so that this resistance value will reduce, because we know that as you increase the dimension of the transistor, the resistance will reduce. So what we are thinking now is, if I increase the dimension of a PMOS transistor, NMOS transistor for driving a large capacity load, will it solve my problem? Will it solve my problem? Yes, it will solve here. You can see why the rise time, fault time is more, because we know that rise time, fault time are proportional to CL. Since CL is large, this rise time and fault times are also large. So with this larger CL, larger load capacitance, if at all, if you want to reduce the rise time and fault time, only possibility is to somehow reduce Rn or Rps. So how do you reduce the values of this resistance offered by the NMOS transistor, PMOS transistor? It is certainly by increasing the W by L ratios of those transistors. So we are now coming to a conclusion that in order to drive a large capacitive load, you simply have a high dimension NMOS and PMOS transistor, because high dimension NMOS and PMOS transistor will offer lesser resistance, so that you can able to end up with a good driving or reduced rise time and fault times. But we don't know what happens. Okay, we are just simply looking at one side of the charging discharging. So, but we have to carefully have a look at it. As you increase the dimension of this PMOS transistor and NMOS transistor, the intention of increasing the dimension is to reduce the resistance of Rp and Rn, which is very good to have a reduced rise and fall time. But you can see, as you increase the dimension of Rp and Rn, we simply looked at what is the resistance. But how about the capacitance offered by this? So as you increase the dimension of Rn and Rp, the capacitance at the input side, because what do you mean by increasing the dimension? You are increasing the W and you are increasing, assume that you are increasing the W value. If you increase the W value, do you know that CGS is also proportional to W? Do you know that C junction is also proportional to W? So these capacitances will also increase. When these capacitances also increase, you can see this driver, which is seeing this as a load, this is actually now get loaded. So in the purpose of reducing the resistance, you have simply increased the dimension of this one. Now the increased dimension will certainly affect the driver itself, so it is not recommended to simply increase the dimension of N and PMOS transistor to drive large capacity loads. It is now not recommended to increase the dimension of this N and PMOS, because that is actually loading my driver, because this driver, which is used to drive this inverter, should also see a very less capacitance. So now we need to make a balance. Now this CL has to be driven by lower resistance, and of course this driver should also see very low input capacitance, which is not possible by a single inverter, meaning a single inverter cannot effectively drive a large capacitance load. So the solution is, you have a large capacity load, this is what is CL, which is very large in nature, and you have a driver, which should see a small CL, Now in between this, instead of having a single inverter, you have a chain of inverters. Now you can see this chain of inverter, we don't know what is the number. By the time you have this load capacitance which is driving this, this will have a larger dimension, so that A larger dimension inverter can offer lesser resistance so that it can charge quickly. See here, okay, the intention of or the requirement of reduced resistance of the inverter which is used to drive the CL is being satisfied by this large inverter which is close to this. And one more condition of this driver should not see very large capacitance is satisfied here. We have here have a less dimension inverter. This is a less dimension inverter. This is a large dimension inverter. So now what we have to have now is we have to have a series of inverter. It's a chain of inverter starting with a small dimension, keep on increasing the dimension so that this doesn't see a huge resistance. So this capacitance can have a lesser resistance so that it can charge and discharge quickly. So let us try to understand, okay, what should be the sizing of these inverters so that you're going to have an optimum delay in the inverter, in the optimum delay in driving a large capacity load. Okay, let us now consider we have an inverter. You can see now we have inverters which are keep increasing like this, and then assume that you have nth stage inverter, you have a load capacitor CL, and assume that you have the capacitance at the first stage is C1. Now let us assume that this is inverter 1, inverter 2, this is 3, 4, this is nth inverter. Let me name this as CN plus 1, this is C1. So let us assume that the R equivalent of this is R1, this is R2, this is R3, this is R4, this is Rn. Suppose if you are looking at what is total TPD, which is now equal to TPD of 1 plus TPD of 2 till TPD of n, which is proportional to overall tau, and then this is tau 1 plus tau 2, because TPD is nothing but you're going to have it as 0.69 R into C. Let us take it as R into C as which is now tau, because tau is nothing but the time constant RC. When I say this RC, it is the overall tau. This is RPD, that is propagation delay or rise time. You can just either write it as rise time or propagation delay. Only thing is that that constant term will change. Here it will be 0.69, here it will be 2.2. So it is TR1 plus TR2 plus TR3, so on, so it just goes on. So now this is tau 2, this is tau 3, just goes on like this, and it is tau n. So let us try to define what is this tau 1, because for tau 1 it is the resistance offered by this, and there is a capacitance of C2 has to be considered. So tau 1 is nothing but it is the resistance of inverter stage 1 and the capacitance of second stage. Let me write it as R1 into C2, and this is R2 into C3, this is R3 into C4, it goes on like that, and finally I'll have Rn into Cn plus 1. So this Cn plus 1 is actually equal to CL. So now this is the overall tau value. This is the overall tau value. but we know what is C1 is. So what is C1? C1 is capacitance of stage 1. C2 is, of course, this is input capacitance. It is input capacitance of stage 2. Here you can see stage 1, stage 2. So what we are trying to have here is, so as I earlier described, so here I have a large capacity load. To have a large capacity load, let me have a large inverter which is driving it, and I have a driver, and I have a driver which is like a clock. The clock should see a very small capacitance, so this should be of very small dimension, this should be of larger dimension. The intermediate stages are keep on increasing in their dimension. So what we'll do is, if this is having some W by L is equal to some X, sorry, some value of 10, you increase the W by L of this by S times. So what is W by L of this now? It is 10 into S. what is 10? 10 is the earlier value. You scale it by s times. So what is the scaling of this now? The previous is 10 into s. You scale this by another s. Scale it by another s. So this is your scaling factor. So s is the scaling factor, which is nothing but by how many times you are increasing compared to the previous one. So the previous one is 10 into s. You increase this by another s times. So what is the stage of this one? It is 10 into s into s into s. So you increase the size of this s times compared to the previous one. So that's what I'm trying to do here. So what is, suppose if I write this one, so it is R1. What is C2? C2 is actually equal to s times C1 plus what is R2? Because R2 you are considering a scaled version of the first stage. Now this R1 is actually equal to R2 is actually scaled version of the previous one. So I can write R2 as R1 by S, because this is scaled by S times compared to the first inverter. The resistance is reduced by S times compared to the first one. So R2 is actually equal to R1 by S, because inverter 2 is scaled by S times compared to inverter. So that's why it is reduced by S times. And how about C3? C3 is what? C3 is S times C2. S times C2. It is S times C2. Then it just goes on like this. It is now R. So it is now equal to R2 by S plus S into. Okay, now this is S into. This is let me write it as, because it is now this is actually C3. You can see here this is actually C3. C3 is nothing but scaled version of the previous one, and this is, you can write it as the scaled version of it is into S into, because you are looking for C4. This is C3. So it just goes on like this. Suppose if you write this one, it is R1 SC1 plus, shall I write it as what is actually C2? C2 is actually SC1. Can I write it as R1 by S, S square into C1? What is this now? It is R1 by S square, S cube into C1. It just goes on like that. The last one will also be, okay, now you are looking at Rn, so which is now Rn is now equal to R1 into S to the power of n minus 1, and it is S power 1 C1. So ultimately what you are trying to get is the overall tau is equal to R1 C1 into S plus, you can see here this will also go off. It is R1 C1 S plus, again this will go with this. Can you see it is R1 C1 S till the last stage? It is again R1 C1 S. What I mean to say here is you are trying to represent each and every time constant in terms of R1 C1, R1 C1, R1 C1, and the scaling factor. So can I write the overall time constant as equal to n times R1 C1 into S, because all of them are same, all of them are same, because you have n such terms, n such terms. So overall propagation delay, so tau total can be written as n into S into tau, the first stage inverter, And we also know that, so what is this, we know that, suppose let us try to understand what is this This is we have the initial inverter having C1 as its input capacitance. What is C2? C2 is actually C1 into S. C1 into S. What is actually C3? C3 is C2 into S. What is C4? It is C3 into S. So what is actually C, suppose if I write it as Cn, or let me write it as Cl. Cl is equal to it's the last stage, which is nothing but you can write it as Cn into S. Cn into S. So Cl can also be written as the input capacitance of n plus one stage. N plus one stage. So now it is C1. I can write C2 as C1 into S, C3 as C1, because C2 can be written as this is C2 can be written as C1s into S. What is C4? C4 is nothing but C1 S square into S. Like my C5 is equal to C1 S power 4. Finally, what can I write this CL as equal to? Can I write it as S power N into C1? Because if you can write here, this C3 is equal to C1 S square. See here? So if you just simply take this, see here, C3, this is the capacitance of third stage. Capacitance of third stage is capacitance of the first stage multiplied by S square. So what I'll do, I'll simply make this as N plus 1. C N plus 1 is equal to, what is this now? It is the first inverter C1. Can you see this is, if it is N plus 1, then is this N? So I can write it as S power N. So what is this N plus 1? This is actually the load capacitance CL. This is actually load capacitance CL. So I can write the load capacitance as equal to S power N into C1. So can I rewrite this as S power N is equal to CL by C1, or can I take natural log on both sides and can I write it as N is equal to natural log of CL by C1 divided by natural log of S. So what is this actual N value? N is nothing but number of stages that are required to drive a large capacity load. So this is the actual N value. This is the value of N now. So we are writing N as equal to natural log of CL by C1. What is this CL? This is the load capacitance. What is this C1? It is the capacitance of the first stage. And what is this S? S is nothing but scaling factor. So S is scaling factor. CL is load capacitance. And C1 is capacitance of stage 1, where N is number of stages required to drive the load. So let us try to understand considering a problem. Suppose if load capacitance is equal to let us take an example of 10 picofarad, and C1, that is the first stage of inverter, has got a capacitance of 20 femtofarad. We are asked to find out what is the value of N required. What is the value of N required? So we know that the expression for the N, that is number of stages, is given by ln of CL by C1 divided by ln of S. So since we are looking for, suppose if the value of, if you just come down here, so we need to make a compromise. If the scaling factor is less, you need to have more stages. If the scaling factor is more, then you can end up with less number of stages. Now, if the number of stages are less, then the input capacitance is more. If the number of stages are more, then you have to have a lot of hardware has to be implemented. So in order to have in optimum value, coming to this expression, the value of n can be optimum if this ln of s is equal to 1. Ln of s is equal to 1. Suppose if you make s is equal to e, which is equal to 2.71, which is equal to 2.71, I will have n as the optimum value. So this will be the optimum value if ln of s is equal to 1. If ln of s is equal to 1. So what is n optimum now? N optimum is ln of Cl by C1. So for this problem, okay, let us also try to find the dimensions of different transistor. Let us assume that the first inverter has got a dimension of this as 20 SW bell. If this has got a dimension of 10, then how many stages are required and what will be the dimension of the MOSFETs? So let us try to understand that. Okay, as we know that this is my load capacitance. Now the condition what I have now is, so this is my inverter. Okay, this is my inverter chain, keep on going up. So I don't know how many stages are required, but ultimately what I have is, I have a load of Cl is equal to 10 picofarad need to be driven by a first stage which is having 20 femtofarad. I want to find what is the number of n, or the number of n, the scaling factor we are assuming. Each subsequent stage, if it is having one dimension, if it is having a scale of 1, then this needs to be scaled by 2.71 times, that is e times it has to scale up. And if it is 2.71, then it is 2.71 into 2.7, because compared to previous one it has to be scaled by 2.71. likewise, it should be keep on increasing. So let us try to find out what is the value of n here. So to find the value of n, you can very easily do it here. N is equal to ln of Cl by C1, which is now equal to ln of 100 picofarad divided by 20 femtofarad, which comes out to be, now it is ln of 10 exponential minus 12 divided by 20 exponential minus 15. So okay, this comes out to be 6.21. this is a value of n. You cannot have an n value which is a fraction. You can either go for n can be either 6 or n can be either 7. N can be either 6 or 7. Suppose you choose the value of n as equal to 6. If you choose the value of n as equal to 6, you can actually find out what will be the dimension of these MOSFETs. So now you can see, you have your first inverter. We have assumed it as okay, let me just write it here only. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. Suppose the first one is having 20 and 10. So then this is 20s and this is 10s. This will be 20s square and this is 10s square. This is 20s cube. This is 10s cube. This is 20s power 4. This is 10s power 4. This is 20s power 5. This is 10s power 5. So what is this? Let me just try to give you for the first stage, second stage, third stage, fourth stage, fifth stage, the sixth stage. Suppose if you take the first stage, the W bell of let me write W bell of P and W bell of N transistor. Here it is 20, here it is 10. The second stage is, how much is 20 into 2.71? It is 54.2. This is 20. Okay, let me just complete this. Into 2.71. This is 146.8 into 2.71. It is 398 into 2.71. It is 1078 into 2.71. You can see now it is 2923 approximately. Coming down to this, it is 20 into 2.71. It is, sorry, 10 into 2.71, it is 27.1 into 2.71, it is 73 approximately into 2.71, it is 199 into 2.71, it is 539 into 2.71, it is 1461. You can see these are the W by L ratios of six different inverter stages. If you now see, this is the dimension of your first stage of inverter for which your driver is connected. So driver is not seeing a very heavy resistance, so very heavy capacitance, because this is of minimum dimension. Now here you can see this is the sixth stage what you have. For the sixth stage you have a very large capacitance. This CL is very large. Since the dimension of these transistors are quite high, so that the resistance offered by this will be less, so that this can able to charge and discharge very quickly. So this was not possible by a single inverter, because if you have a single inverter which is connected to the driver, you can see this driver will see a very huge resistance. So instead of going for, so assume that now this is your driver. If your driver is there, can you see your driver is seeing a very less capacitance, because its capacitance is less because the dimension is less. Can you see this is 10 picofarad capacitance and it is scaled up by S power 5 into 20. This is your earlier initial minimum value. It is scaled up by 5 times. So it is scaled up. It's not into 5, it is 5 square. So it is 2.71 to the power of 5 times it has scaled up. So that resistance is reduced so that it can charge as well as discharge quickly. So this way we can certainly use of course if you consider this n is equal to 7, we are going to certainly have a different dimension here. So this way we can able to actually find out what is the dimension of what is the dimension of each of the transistor. So this is how you can able to design an inverter for driving large capacitive loads.